欧阳家之间的很深的联系，联系方式一直想到这边。From this side of the world, you see that many of the countries which have been very much involved in this so-called Arab Spring are exporters of oil and gas, and many of them actually have this device is the country of Israel. Actually, all these four countries are there, Egypt, Libya, and Yemen have been supplies of many Asian Pacific countries over the last two or three decades. And therefore, there is uncertainty about the availability of supply. When it comes to Libya, it has already become a reality. Because of the civil war, they have actually witnessed a serious decrease in the export capability. But the major fear is that what if this situation actually expands to other countries, in particular major exporters of the Persian Saudi Arabian Kuwait, that have Oman and the United Arab Emirates. This is not just a theoretical concern, but practical, because interestingly enough, all these countries have also experienced a degree of disarray. However, being in a much better situation, at least financially and also perhaps security, and having perhaps more serious type of support from many Western countries, including the United States, they have managed to actually suppress the rise of dissent in their countries. Yet, there is no certainty that they can do it in the future, because, for instance, Saudi Arabia, despite what people think about it, it is a very unstable country. It has many sources of problems. One is that 30% of its population are of Shia condition, and therefore these 30% have traditionally been suppressed by the ruling elite who actually promote the Wahhabism to the sect of the Sunni. This is one of the major problems there. There are also the rise of extremists, the Sunnis within the country, who are actually challenging the power and authority of development on religious. At the same time, there has been a movement towards secularization, including a relatively serious movement by women demanding equality. So far, all this has been suppressed, but the Saudi Arabia has far too many problems to be suppressed in the long term. So this Arab Spring, so on Arab Spring, could well expand to Saudi Arabia and also other countries that we can see on this. But there's also concern about the availability of African supplies, Arab African supplies, including, for instance, those of Sudan and Nigeria. Sudan has known that actually witnessed a very dramatic development in the system in July, as the country was officially divided into two countries. The problem is that the bulk of Sudan's oil reserves are now within the southern part. And therefore, one could expect that there will be continued conflict between the north and south over ownership of that resource. Strangely enough, for you that the main investors in the oil industry of that country are China, India, and Malaysia, which have been counting on that part of the world as a reliable source of long-term supplies. But they also see it as a kind of financial problem, because if the situation continues to stay there, we do actually get significant amount of investment in that country. Nigeria, as you probably know, has been facing serious internal problems, lawlessness and war, civil war for the last 10 years or so. Therefore, it is also, there are serious doubts about its capability to continue supplying Asia in particular. Iran is also another thing. Iran has been the second largest oil and gas reserve, and therefore it is indispensable when it comes to supplying in Asian countries in the long term. However, it has been faced a wide range of unilateral and also UN approved sanctions with some degree of limit on its export capability. Today it is not major, but if these type of problems, including internationally enforced, in this case, restriction on banks to facilitate Iran's export is creating a problem, and it will create major problems for Iran's export. So you have this situation. At the same time, there is a growing concern that perhaps at least some Western countries, in particular NATO countries, are not considering actually strategically occupying Arab countries or African countries with significant foreign that system. But in fact, the involvement of NATO in Libya has actually contributed to this view that perhaps this is becoming a trend in many parts of it. But the other issue is that the issue of affordability, because we have had all these problems, but if you look at them, these problems have created not only the concern about availability of supply, but also affordability. As you can see, for instance, when it comes to food oil, because of the mentioned problems on other issues, mainly political state security issues, there has been a dramatic increase in the price of oil, food oil, for instance, between August 2010 and 2011, as you can see, there has been at least a $24 increase in terms of the price of a barrel of oil. But this is not confined to oil only. It is also true for the cheapest possible type of fossil energy, which is coal. Again, as you can see that over the 1 year period, we have witnessed a significant increase, about $25 per metric ton of coal, because of certain factors. One is, of course, the growing consumption of coal, because it is the cheapest possible type of energy, especially in our region. But it is also because of the fact that many countries are actually experiencing depletion of resources, such as, for instance, Indonesia and many other regional countries, and therefore using more coal is becoming more a kind of acceptable option, and therefore demand is expanding. At the same time, at least in the short term, Japan's sudden consumption of a larger amount of coal to compensate for the loss of Fukushima nuclear reactors has also contributed to a shortage of supply with the effect on price. So as you can see that at least high oil prices will remain a fact of life, which will also affect the prices of other types of energy, including coal and gas. There is also a kind of new concern, environmental concern. As I mentioned to you earlier, that global warming is becoming quite serious issue. It is not confined to this region. Also, it is affecting regions such as the Arctic, you know, whose melting is going to create major problems unless we actually reverse this drastic trend. So there is a necessity to actually deal with issues and to refer many Asian countries, as you can see, China, India, Japan, and also South Korea, have taken the steps towards that. So in the case of South Korea, it has actually expanded its power generation by using more nuclear energy, and also expanded its use of solar and wind. And so in that case, and also in the case of China, Japan, and India, we can actually talk about an impressive increase in clean energy. But the fact is that despite these type of factors of structure, generally speaking, the trend is towards consumption of more fossil energy, and therefore we have to actually deal with this issue of global warming, and therefore cutting oil and gas and coal consumption is becoming more serious. The other issue related to that is actually we are witnessing this situation at the time when some of the alternatives that I mentioned, biofuels, have proven to be kind of false hope, and as I mentioned to you earlier. So what I want to actually add to this issue is the fact